and I'll make sure I pause the video.
And we are live, or we should be at least. So if you are in the chat, let us know that you can hear us and see us. The pattern for this project is on my website, thefrugalcrafter.wordpress.com. If you want to print it out and transfer it onto your paper, if not, you could just kind of sketch it in as we go if you like. I am joined here today, as always, with Sarah.
Hello!
And she will be relaying your questions to me. So if you have a question, make sure you type it in all caps so she will catch it, because sometimes the chat goes a little fast, and that way we won't miss out. And we're not going to answer the same questions over and over again. So if your question doesn't get answered, it's probably because it's already been asked. And just, you know, catch the replay later from the beginning, and you'll hear it. So that way it won't be too repetitive for the folks that are sticking the whole way through. Of course, I guess anybody that's hearing me say that now wouldn't be around when they're asking the question. Oh, good thinking, right? This video is brought to you by jerrysartorama.com. You can find all of the products I'm using there, as well as pretty much anything you want for your arts and crafts needs. The first thing I'm going to do is wet my paper. And I've already sketched my design on. What I did was I sketched it on scrap paper, and then I just transferred the details that I needed. I tried not to put too much detail on this because I didn't want to have a bunch of extraneous marks. And also because if I change my mind and want to put an extra flower or eliminate one, I could do that. And I'm working on 140-pound cold-pressed watercolor paper in a block. I'm going to go ahead and switch to a large round brush so I can't get too fussy when I use a nice big round brush like that. And I'm going to use some Cad Yellow Medium. And I'm going to drop some of that in my sunflower areas. I'm not going to worry about any bleeding in the background, because I want to have kind of a soft background, and these colors are going to kind of whoosh and goosh out, and that's exactly what I want. We're just putting a background in right now. I'm going to use some green. I think I'm going to take a little sap green and just kind of throw some in around the vase and in around my flowers. Not everywhere. I just want to get some color down, and it will dry a little lighter. So kind of keep that in mind. Next, I'm going to grab some cobalt blue. You could use ultramarine. Just add a little more water to it, because that's a little bit stronger of a color. I just want to have some soft colors so I don't have any just sharp, you know, hard edges in my background. Now I want to take a little Cad Orange, because I think I'm going to want some of that in my sunflowers. And I am going to mix it with my blue to make a gray. That's a really strong color. You can see how it's overtaking that cobalt. So I'm going to take a little bit of that and add some cobalt to it. I'll keep that on my palette because I might use it for something else.
Gracie Shack, what colored pencils would you recommend? I need to get some decent color pencils, but I am on an art budget.
Let's see. Budget, regular colored pencils. Boy, let's see. The Soho, she's also in the UK, so I don't know what. There's a company called Kohinoor in there, out of the Czech Republic. And I think that in Europe, they're not crazy expensive. They're decent. They're not my favorite, but they're pretty decent. I really like Polychromos by Faber-Castell, and they're out of Germany. So it may be affordable for you to get those. They're really expensive here, but they might not be too bad where you're at. So I would check, Faber-Castell first and their Polychromos. And if those are too crazy expensive, look at what Kohinoor has to offer. And if anybody else from the UK is in the chat and they have a recommendation, because I know your prices are something that's really expensive here might be cheap over there and vice versa. So if you have a recommendation for her, please, please let her know. If you have any puddles, I don't think I have any right now, but what I like to do if I do have a puddle is I dry my brush off and I just set it in the puddle, and it just absorbs the extra water so I won't end up with a ruffle where I don't want it. And now I'm going to dry this with my heat tool, but if you have any questions, just keep asking them.
Rovina Latau, do you have any storage ideas for A3 size paper?
I am not sure what A3 size is. So if somebody could hop in the chat and let me know what the measurements are for A3, that would be great, because I only know like 8.5 by 11 is like our standard size, and it's pretty close to the A2, but or A4. I'm not sure. But we'll wait and see if she comes back. Does anybody else have a question?
Yep. LJC7271. If you pencil sketch prior to watercolor, is there any danger that the graphite will come through similar to acrylic paints? Thank you.
Sometimes if you use a really soft lead, your pencil sketch will smear when you watercolor over it. So if you use a harder lead, like any pencil that has an H, not an HB, but just the letter H after its number, the higher the number, the harder the lead and the light of the lines, it shouldn't smear. Also, if you use transfer paper, like I did here, it's just like a waxed type of sheet with graphite on it. When you use that to transfer a design, it leaves almost like a little bit of a waxy coating over the graphite, so it does not smear. So those are a couple different options for you there. If you use a really soft lead pencil, it's going to smear a little bit. But and sometimes you can go in and erase your lines when you're done too. Just go in with a soft white eraser and erase over your painting if they bother you. I actually like the look of some pencil lines in mine, but it's completely personal preference.
Rovina Latow, just wanted to ask, how do you get your dry watercolors back?
How do you get your dry watercolors back? Do you mean how do you revive them?
I'm gonna assume that's what she means.
I just use a wet brush and lift up my paint, because I squeeze these out from the tubes into my palette. These are all my M. Graham colors. They're my favorites. And I had the room now down here to have this palette out. I squeeze it out, and then when I'm ready to paint, I just use a wet brush. But if your paint is not coming to life very well, squirt it with some water, let it sit for 5 or 10 minutes, and then go in and paint, and you're gonna find that it will it'll come back much better for you. So now what I want to do is switch to a slightly smaller brush. Oh, and try to remember not to leave your brushes sitting in water, because if the wood gets soaked, then it'll expand and it'll crack the paint, and then the ferrule will become loose, and it's difficult to paint with. So I'm going to switch over to a number 8 round, and I'm going to, I think I want to make my own dark, and I'm using some mauve. And I'm going to add a little bit of sap green to that, I think. Because they're fairly close to opposites, so I think they'll make a nice brown. And if I want to darken that, I can use a little cobalt blue. And if you don't have the exact colors I'm using, just, you know, you could use burnt sienna in place of this. I just thought it'd be fun to work with some different colors today. And I'm going to start adding some of the shadows into the centers of my sunflowers. I have to get my darks in first, because it helps me establish value. You can see that almost looks black on my painting, those three colors mixed together. I don't want to put too much detail. I just want to kind of skip around and get some of the detail in here.
Alley Cat, have you ever tried using watercolor markers?
Yeah, I use them a lot for rubber stamping, and I also really like the Winsor & Newton watercolor markers because they're light fast and they blend really easily. So, but they don't have as many colors. I think it's because they're light fast. There aren't too many pigments they can put in a marker and have them flow. But I recommend those. And there are cheaper ones that are not light fast though too, that are marketed to crafters. So I would definitely check those out if you're looking to get started. That way you can try without a big investment. Now I'm adding a little bit more of that. I have remember that dirty cold cadmium orange we had? I'm just pulling a little bit of that in my color, and I'm going to be adding that into my center as well. You can leave some little light spots peeking through to kind of sparkle and highlight a little bit. So you don't want to fill everything in.
Grell Sutcliffe. Hi, Lindsay. Have you ever used Faber-Castell Pitt Artist Pens or watercolor crayons?
Yes, I haven't used the Faber-Castell watercolor crayons. Well, actually, you know what? I did use some, but they were the kids ones. They weren't the artist ones. I'm grabbing a little, yellow ochre. I had mixed a very close to a yellow ochre color, but I think I want the
actual texture of the yellow ochre paint here. Yeah, I like the Pitt Artist pens. They're an India ink pen, so if you used like say you wanted to do like a sketch or just a, like a little wash or underpainting with them on your watercolor paper, you can. And then when you go over it with your watercolor, it won't run. So it's kind of fun to use in conjunction with your watercolor paints or your other mixed media supplies.
Gracie Shack, have you used Create a Color Aqua Crayons and do you like them?
I have not used that brand. I have some, the Soho pencils are made by Create a Color and I've used those, but I haven't used any of their water solubles that I can think of anyway.
Cuppycake, what brand of watercolor can you please recommend, but at the same time cheap?
Let's see, my favorite cheap watercolor. Well, you know, if you're in the United States right now, I don't know if you can get these. Well, you probably can get them in other countries because I think they're Japanese made. The Turner watercolors are, they have an 18 set of 5 milliliter tubes for $29 at Jerry's. And those are artist quality and quite inexpensive. If you want like a slightly lower quality, the Koi sets are pretty good. If you live in the United States, you can get them at the big box stores, which are nice because you can use a coupon on them. They still run $30 for a pan set, you know, regular price. But if you can get them someplace where, you know, they have the coupons and you can score them for a deal. Those are two pretty good ones. I like the Reeve set too for budget. I think the Koi might actually be a little bit more vivid, a little bit stronger pigment, but I think the Reeves are a little more transparent. So, I mean, they're out there, you know, you just depends on what your, you know, major objectives are, what you absolutely want your paints to do. But those are pretty safe bets.
The earlier question about the dry watercolor paints, yep. The tube of watercolor paints itself is dry, apparently not dry on a palette.
Oh, cut the tube away and just plop that right in one of your palette wells and just spritz it with water. Just take a little X-Acto knife or a pair of scissors, get in there and slice off the tube.
Janine's Craft Room, if I don't have CAD orange, what would you recommend to make that gray color?
Just take a burnt sienna and cobalt. Those two will work pretty good. And then you can use the burnt sienna in other brown areas if you like. I like having the yellow ochre here and then dabbing in the mauve just because it gives you a very colorful brown. So that's what I'm trying to get. I want my flowers to feel very fresh. And these flowers are on their last legs. I got them for my birthday for my little nephew. And I really wanted to paint them in watercolor, but I hadn't been feeling well this week. So this was my opportunity to do it. So I'm just hoping I can keep a few petals on there until we're done. Now I'm taking a little bit of this mauve and I'm going to just loosely tap in some of the little purple flowers here.
Kathleen Townsend, couldn't find the traceable on your blog. Will you be uploading that?
It is. I was a little late getting it up there. Went up a little, right around noontime. It's there. You just got to I click on it and then it'll bring it up in a larger window and then I would right click and either choose print or save as depending on. If you want to save it or not, but it's there now. I was just a little late today. I'm going to take a little bit of cobalt and add it to that mauve to darken it up and add some of that darker color right in there and just let it flow. And that's what I like about these paints is they really flow well and don't fuss with anything too much because we want to keep that freshness. So now we've got a little more interesting color here because we have two pigments mingling there, but it's really lively and fresh because we're mixing it on the paper instead of on the palette and then bringing it to the paper. There's times to do both, but this is a looser type of painting.
Maxine Perry, have you tried Senlier watercolor paints or pastels? What's your opinion?
I haven't, but Marty Owens from Owens Art has recommended them to me. I was actually doing a little shopping the other day and I had my cart open and I was had a Facebook page open with Marty saying, what do you think of these? What do you think of those? And I just couldn't bite the bullet on the Seleniers. They were a little pricey. They were for me, for considering how much stuff I have already, they're a little on the on the pricey side, but I've heard nothing but good things about them. In fact, they were in Marty's top three, so
and he would know.
He would know. He tests a lot of these out, so.
Ian Jackson, A3 is 16.5 by 23 inches.
Wow.
How to store that paper. There was a
inches.
Story.
Wow. 16 by 23?
Yeah.
Well, okay, what I use, because I have some pastel paper that's big like that. Not centimeters, huh? Inches. Wow.
Well, he has it in millimeters, 420 millimeters by 594 millimeters, which translates to 16 and a half by 23.4 inches. Thank you, Ian.
You can translate millimeters to inches? Wow.
You converted it for us.
Oh,
thank
he converted
you, Ian.
It. Wow, thank you,
I
Ian.
Didn't know.
Oh, like, but you are sharp today, Sarah.
I am not. The heat is melting my brain.
We have these drug stores called Rite Aid in our country, and when anytime any of these drug stores got a business, they sell all their displays really cheap, and I bought their poster board displays. And by the way, I'm just wetting this and putting in some sap green. And they'll sell their poster board displays for like $5 or $10. And I grabbed a couple of those and I use those for storing my pastel paper sheets and also, for using as drying racks and stuff. They do make those for sale, on art supply websites like Jerry's, but, they are expensive. So if you can find a store going out of business that sells poster board, that's what I would do. Or you could like maybe fashion something out of some foam core, or I don't know. So I'm a big fan of cinder blocks and plywood, stacking those up and making stuff. Those would be my suggestions. So I think we're going to do some green mixing because I don't want to just use sap green. So let's take a look at what we can do with our greens here. So here we got sap green. It's a beautiful green. It is a mix. If you buy sap green, it's a mix. So if we take the sap green, and then we could add a little cobalt blue to it. So we're using the stuff we've already been using. We get a nice earthy dark green, great for shadows. If we take a little bit of the cad orange that we were using and add that into some of our greens, it's really going to brown it up. If we take just a little touch of that and our sap green, we'll get a really, really earthy kind of olivey color. We can add some yellow in there. So all these colors, we can bring together to make some really beautiful greens and have a really good variety when we're painting our sunflowers and the stems and the leaves. So the stalks are really quite yellow. So I'm going to kind of take this yellowier mix, and I could see one stalk here, and I'm just going to fill that in. So it's in a nice yellow green. And by using, and you'll notice like the higher quality of paint that you use, because I really think you should paint with whatever you have, and not let, you know, your budget keep you from creating art. But one of the reasons you would spring for a higher end paints would be because the pigment strength is stronger, and the fact that they're usually made with single pigments, and the more single pigments you have, the brighter colors you can get when you mix them. When pigments become mixed, the brightness becomes diluted a little bit. So you want to be able to keep that really strong, bright color. Oh, and I do want to give a shout out to my friend Rich Bowden, who has a YouTube channel, The Spin Doctor, and he might be here with us today, but he's got a color chemistry series on his channel, and he talks about why different colors do what they do. He has, he knows all about the chemicals, properties, and all that stuff. So if you are interested in learning more, definitely check that out. It might be a little overwhelming, all the information that he's got on there, but it's really neat to know.
Just a reminder too, for people who have requests for classes or videos, they can do that on your blog.
Yep.
There's an option for requests for tutorials. So we've had a couple in the chat.
Oh,
so I just
want
to let people know, go to her blog. She has an option for, tutorial requests. And sometimes even if you search her past videos, you can find something along those lines.
Yeah. In fact, searching first before putting a request is great, because oftentimes, you'll see that I've already done that video, or I might even have several. Like, I have several lilac watercolor videos. Not to say that I wouldn't do any more, because I love painting lilacs. I just haven't, last couple of years, I haven't managed to pick any before they've gone by. But yeah, so that will just save you a little time too. If you see that it's already there, you can
get to a lot quicker.
Jen K, thanks you for checking out and following her on PMP. It made her day.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, and if you guys are on PMP, drop me a note there. Because a lot of times when I'm looking for, when I'm trying to find a picture, I'm just searching that, searching an image. I'm not necessarily searching a person's gallery. I'm just, you know, searching, you know, for sunflowers or searching for lilacs or whatever. So yeah, if you drop a note, then I can go right in and look at your gallery. And I keep little photo albums where I kind of put my favorites in. So that way when I'm ready to paint, sometimes I just sit down and look at pictures and put stuff in albums. So that just helps me not forget or not lose somebody's info or gallery.
Gracie Shack, how can you stop brown watercolor mixing going muddy?
Try to keep your mixes fresh. Don't use too many colors. And part of that is the quality of paint. You know, if you're using more single pigment colors, you're going to have fresher mixes. I'm going in a little bit of a darker green here. And so I've got kind of some sap and some cobalt going on there. And I'm going in and adding just some little marks at the base of some of these purple flowers. The ones that are kind of the side view. I think maybe I could grab one and show you here. Hopefully without knocking all the petals off my flowers. Oh, you know what? Let me grab a pair of scissors. Let me cut off one.
It's probably easier.
Yeah, let me just cut one off here. So if I'm looking at this petal and I'm seeing it sideways, I see all these little kind of spiky green, almost like they're probably leaves, but they look almost like green petals. Then I've got the purple petals. But if I'm looking at it straight on, I could see the yellow center. And if I'm looking at it kind of like three quarters of the way, I might see a little peak of that yellow center there. So I just wanted to kind of get some of these flowers going in different directions just for a little bit of interest there. So the green, I'm just going in first and putting in some of the darker green marks on some of them, the ones that I'm seeing from the side that I don't see the yellow on. And that one I already put some green in, so I can go and just kind of paint some of the darker ones in now, just to give me a little bit of contrast and texture and interest in there. And I did put in some of the yellow centers on some of the ones I could see, and they're probably dry, so I can go in with some I like to go in with kind of the mauve on its own and then go in with a little bit of the mauve and cobalt and let them kind of mix. So I'll just do little choppy strokes here. I see I missed one there. I'm going to go and put some of the mauve in right now. And it's kind of fun to do a bouquet because when something's wet, you can skip over to something else. You don't have to be stuck waiting or using a heat tool to dry a petal so you can go on. So that's kind of nice. I don't know what these are. If anybody knows what they are, let me know in the comments. I think they might be bachelor buttons. Do you know?
I don't think they're bachelor buttons. They might be like a mum, like a type of mum.
Oh, yeah, maybe they are. They do kind of look like a mum, don't they?
They could, I mean, maybe they are a bachelor, but I think bachelor buttons are smaller and they're more like a papery.
Oh.
I could be wrong.
You're probably right. You know more about flowers than I do.
A little bit. I usually cheat and look it up in my flower book.
That works.
I'm not sure. Dominique Designs. Lindsay, are you using your new camera?
Yeah.
Great picture.
Oh, good, good.
I've moved over here because people are saying they're having a hard time hearing me, so I'm hoping that I'm a little more front. Back and center.
Well, the microphones are on either side. So actually, if you're over where you were when you first got here today, that before you scooted back.
I'll do this. I need my footstool. That's the whole clincher as to why I'm sitting.
Oh, there you go. There you go. You comfortable now?
Because it's all about me, people. All about me.
Yes. Join us next week for the Sarah Show.
Kelly Shirk, Lindsay, do you have a viewing gallery of some of your bigger art pieces?
Not really. I post pretty much everything on my blog as I do it, but it's not really organized. You could just like click on the painting tab, the painting search tag, and look at paintings. That's pretty much it. I don't sell online because I don't want to deal with shipping, and especially shipping larger things like paintings. I have a little shop in Brewer that I just put everything in once I have it framed. I pretty much just post it as I do it, and it's only stuff that I've been doing since I've been since I've been online, so nothing too old.
Patricia Glika, have you ever used Peerless watercolors?
I have. They're nice. They're just not really for me because I like lots of juicy, flowy color, and I just found them to be, I don't know, I just don't really like the process of, because like Peerless colors or watercolors are on a piece of like fabric in a little booklet, and I just found them to be a little too limiting, and for what they were, I think they're kind of expensive. I think they're nice if you're like, you just want something to take with you, or maybe to color a few stamped images, because they're very easy to control. You get a look kind of like Copic Marker with them, but they just really weren't for me. But there's nothing wrong with them. They're fine products.
Sharon Earle, do you have that walled well spot on your palette for a specific reason?
Oh, right here. Yes, it's hot. My hot glue Payne's Gray area. So Payne's Gray doesn't make the cut into my regular palette, but it gets the, it'll get in there.
Special
occasion. Oops, that's the yellow I'm using. Okay, so I'm going to go in. I'm going to start off with some fairly watery cad yellow medium. You can use cad yellow hue. You can use gamboge. Use whatever warm yellow you prefer. I like it because it's nice and strong. It tints really well. And even though it's a cad color, I have it thinned down pretty well because it's such a strong color that when I thin it down, it is transparent. It can be kind of opaque when you use it, straight out of the tube or fairly thickly, but it's certainly strong enough that you can thin it down and use it like this. Okay, so I'm just kind of basing in these petals. And then I'm going to grab a little cad orange. Sounds like some hot rods are racing by.
Bike's going by.
And I'm going to add some cad orange into some of these here. And I'm just kind of tapping it into the base of some of these wet petals and letting it flow.
Now I'm going to use a little mauve because I know that'll give me some interesting results. They're opposites, so next to each other they'll pop, but as they mix, they will negate each other's color a little bit. So just to give it a little bit more interest.
Two World Swings, is this wet on wet?
These petals are wet on wet, yes. A little bit of color in there.
And I can also do a little yellow ochre to kind of tone things down a little bit. You could also use like raw sienna if you don't have yellow ochre. It's just kind of like an earthy yellow.
But it can become muddy, so just try not to get too carried away. Now I do want to use my credit card scraper. Hopefully I have one handy here.
Seems like I always, they're like bad pennies. I always have them when I don't need them. They're always in my way.
If you're looking for one, there's never one nearby.
Yep. I think I'd probably find, oh, you know what? I'll just use the end of a paintbrush.
This is great video, isn't it, guys?
It is.
Actually,
this is real life.
Real life. Now I'm just going to use this palette knife because got it in my smart art box
this month. And I'm just going to scrape in some details. I actually prefer my credit card scraper to like all the purchased kind of scribing tools that are out there because it's easier to maneuver.
Cupcake, have you ever tried painting anime?
No, I've tried it. It just is not for me. It's not my style, really. I'm going to wet all of these blossoms over here on this big sunflower, and we're going to be seeing green and yellow here because you're seeing the flower from the kind of the hip, and it's slightly turned away from us. And I'm just going to kind of let some paint just flow in here. Grab some different colors and just let them do their thing.
Rochelle Don Paul. Hi, Lindsay. I was thinking of buying a whole new set of paints for my birthday. I'm leaning more towards loose paints rather than a ready-made palette. What colors would you recommend?
I would recommend getting a warm and cool version of each primary, like cad yellow, lemon yellow, or cad yellow light and cad yellow medium, something that's so you have a warm and a cool. Ultramarine blue and phthalo blue. Cad Red and Quinacridone Magenta, and then I'd probably also get Burnt Sienna and Sap Green, just because I like Sap Green. But you know, if you could mix the Sap Green color from those, I just find it very handy to have Sap Green. And yellow ochre would be a good one too.
Shelly Parchman, I thought you were done answering.
Oh, no problem.
Any tips painting an impressionist watercolor? I'm very much thinking Van Gogh here, or Van Gogh, or however people.
We usually say Van Gogh, but Van Gogh, I believe, is
the correct
way. I would, you know what? I would actually go check out like Turner and John Singer Sargent, and they were painting during the impressionistic era right around there, and you can kind of get some really good inspiration. I would say go paint in plein air, paint outside, and kind of try to catch the impressions as you're seeing them. That way you can't fuss with it too much. And I think that will give you that impressionistic look that you want. Now I'm just going and adding some colors that I've been using in the vase because I want to make sure that everything matches and makes sense. You can make some really interesting grays and browns and stuff with your palette. Like I'm taking this bluish purpley color and adding it to the brownie color there, and it's giving me a really nice dark gray color.
Brianna Brown, do you have any experience using a UV resistant clear coat spray paint to seal a watercolor piece to display?
I don't seal my watercolors, so no, I don't. I frame them under glass, and I find that to be sufficient. Or if I'm not going to be framing them right away, I mat them and I put them in an archival clear bag. So I really don't think you should rely on a sealer to protect your paintings. I think you're so much better off to put them under glass. I apologize if you can hear that. When I did a test, actually, the furnace was on earlier, and the furnace, you couldn't even hear it on the on the microphone. So I'm hoping that's still the case.
Jerry L. Lindsay, how do you know what picks to do wet on wet or wet on dry?
Basically, if I want it to blend or not. If I want blending, then I know I want to paint wet on wet. Or I want to paint it wet on dry and then have a wet brush and kind of smooth out the edges. Taking a little bit of that cobalt because I feel like I want to have like a water line in here, and it might be a little easier to get in there with some blue. Clean my brush and drag it down because that's a little bright. And then we'll have to go back in after it's all dry and sharpen up that line because it got very fuzzy. How many people do we have visiting with us
today? 270 watching.
Nice.
Yeah. Back up to where I was.
They're chatty today, aren't they?
Yes, there's great chat. People are answering each other's questions, stuff like that. So some questions I have to skip, and then I have to get, of course, then I hit the end, and then it comes back to the questions pop up, so I can go back to where I was. Da, 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 da. But thankfully, everyone's very patient with me.
Oh, I wanted to show you my water bucket really quick. It doesn't really matter what you use for a water bucket, but it's good to have two vessels for water. One is what you wash your brush in. So when I go to clean my brush, I wash it here. When I need fresh water, I pick it up from the clean side. So I just wanted to show that to anybody that's new. I am going to just kind of loosely wet a sunflower shape back here. This one is in the distance, so I really don't want it to be too detailed. So I'm just going to be dropping in color and letting it do its thing. I'm going to use a little mauve, actually, to begin with, because I really love how when those colors mix, they get that really pretty brownish yellow. And it's going to give me some contrast next to that flower.
Kathy Brenneman, flowers seem to be one of your favorites to watercolor.
They are. I like the color. I like they're cheerful and happy.
Ian Jackson, did you find it easy to set up your new webcam?
Yeah, it was very easy. Actually, I didn't have to download anything because my other camera was a Logitech as well. So it just detected when I opened up my old webcam software, it detected this camera as being what it was, the C915, I believe. And yeah, it was very easy. I love, see, I just love how those two colors do their thing, and I don't even want to do anything else to it because it's just such a pretty effect. Maybe just add a little bit more of the mauve over here just to balance it out a little bit, but I just love that effect. And now I'm going to do the flowers here. And I think I'll go right in with the cad yellow.
And just paint them in, and we'll do a similar treatment that we did right there.
Nona Lawton, what would you suggest trying to paint first for a total beginner?
Probably landscapes, like a sunset is a really good, there's a reason why a lot of those sip and paint places do sunsets, because it's a very easy motif to do. You just get the kind of focus on blending your colors for the sunset, and then you can put any like objects you want in there, whether they're trees or buildings or branches or whatever. Just put that in silhouette. Just do it with like a dark mix of paint, and then it looks great. So that's what I'd recommend. I do have a few sunsets in watercolor on my channel. If you just search I have a landscape playlist, and I would pick one of the sunsets, and that's a great place to start because it's very easy to begin that way. I'm putting a little bit of the brown mix that I had on my palette in here. You could use burnt sienna if you don't have a brown mix going.
Maybe I'll drop a little mauve into that brown mix just to give it a little bit of interest.
Joe Maisky, any general tips for working on a full or half sheet size painting?
I would recommend getting a nice big like plywood board or something you could tape it to. And then I would say don't rush it because that's a lot of ground to cover. If you have like an easel or something you can set it up on when you're not working, so you can kind of think about it when you're walking by it, kind of take a look at it so it's not hidden away. That'll help because when you're painting really large like that, and especially if you're painting flat, it can be really easy to get skewed and not really see what your painting really looks like. So if you can kind of have it taped on something so you can display it or so you can stand back from it, it's really going to help because you'll see if you're making errors or if something isn't quite right, where if you're real close to it, it's going to be difficult to be objective. So that would be my advice. And keep it somewhere where your kids or pets can't disturb it.
Mess with it.
Oh, I remember when my mother was babysitting Jackson, and I had my easel. I'd have it set up in the office because I didn't have a studio down here. It was before, I think it was before the girls were born. No, I don't know. It was either, or they were really little. They might have been really little, and mom was probably busy with them, and I had gone to do some errands or something. And so my easel was set up in the office, and probably mom was busy with the twins because Jackson disappeared for a little while, and he had found a tube of alizarin crimson Liquitex
Oh
acrylic paint. And
no.
he was covered head to toe. The easel was covered head to toe. My poor mother. I go home, she's like, I'm so sorry. I laughed at those.
Gracie
Getting funny.
Shack, who are Lindsay's favorite artists slash inspires or inspiration?
Gosh, I really like I like Marc Chagall, and I actually got to see some of his work on display in Hawaii when my husband and I went on our honeymoon 15 years ago. I like Moreau. I like Salvador Dali. I like people that do art that's different than mine, I think, because it's, I really admire that. I admire abstract painting. I admire surrealist painting. I like colorful, cheerful paintings. Moreau was very colorful and cheerful. He seemed like he was a very cheerful person instead of the, typical temperamental artist you hear about.
Dominique Designs. Lizzie, are those your birthday flowers? How are they still alive and so pretty?
Oh, they are barely making it. They're like just hanging on for dear life. Because I've been wanting to paint them all week, and I did a little knife painting, a little quick one the other day, but I just hadn't felt up to painting. It's like I'm gonna do them Friday. So I went outside to change the water, and I laid them on the ground so I could just kind of rinse out the vase with the hose. And I lost so many petals, and there are like petals on my table, and I'm just hoping
I have enough to look at as long as the stream goes.
I think you'll be all right.
Yeah, I think so too.
I haven't seen any fall off yet. Dominique Designs, are Reeves the same brand as Liquitex?
Well, it's funny. Reeves are the Reeves, unless they've sold, Reeves are produced by Winsor & Newton as kind of like an intro to painting product. And Liquitex is now owned by Winsor & Newton. So they might be related that way. I don't know about manufacturing or not. I don't find them to be bad at all. Especially with the acrylics. I notice more differences in watercolors because I paint with watercolors more often, but I've used their oils and their acrylics too, and I haven't had any problems with it. I haven't noticed anything fading, but I don't use it that much, so I probably couldn't tell you definitively whether they'll fade or not, but I find it to be a pretty reliable brand, especially if you're looking for like kind of a non-toxic paint for children or a beginner. I think, though, the tubes are kind of small, so probably, like, with watercolors and oils, once you get to a point where you're confident with your painting, you're probably going to actually end up saving money by buying a bigger tube from an artist's line, just because you're going to get more in a tube, and once you divide that out and you figure out that you're using less of the artist grade, you'll end up being kind of ahead of the game. But it can be a bit to, you know, part with, you know, $8 for a tube of paint. If you're just starting out, so when you can get a set for, you know, $10, so.
Charity Olson, I use a lot of white in my mixed media. Is there a brand that has a better white?
For white, honestly, there's not. Well, people might disagree with me with this, but I think for white, get the cheapest white. It's titanium dioxide and acrylic emulsion. It's not like they're outsourcing some crazy, hard to find, expensive mineral. It's white is white. And I would get whatever's cheaper. I usually get like Permabella for oil because I can get big tubes of it cheap. I get Chromacryl for acrylic because it's cheap. And I really like their quality. They have a blockout white that I like really well. And you get a big bottle of it. And it's fairly thick, actually, for a bottled paint. And it's cheap. And it's just ideal for classes. It covers really well. So, and that's Chromacryl. It's made by the Chroma company that does have an artist line, but white's white. Well, I mean, white is like what they put in paints to stretch it, that titanium dioxide. That's what they use for filler to stretch a lot of paints, you know? So why buy it, you know, from a high-end company when it's just white?
Well, my question is, if it's for mixed media, couldn't you buy like a bottle of just like crap, like a good brand, like a Folk Art titanium white, because they make titanium white?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
You know, because you can get a big bottle of Folk Art titanium white for $4 or $5, especially mm-hmm. if it's just for mixed media, like, I don't know, just throwing it out.
Well,
there.
You know, I don't know if she's doing like art journal mixed media or she's doing like
that's
mixed
true.
Media art pieces for sale,
cause... that's true. Yeah, she didn't specify which. Yeah. But I would say if it's just for your own journal, use the inexpensive craft.
It should be acid free. It should be acid free anyway.
And then for your, if you're selling pieces, you could use the artist brand. I don't know. Just throwing it out there.
Yeah, I don't think that I don't think the Folk Art would be acidic or anything, or the ceram coat or whatever. I'm adding I added some water around my flowers because I felt like I wanted like some kind of thicker foliage in here. And so I'm just kind of adding some sap green to the shadows. I'm just kind of, you know, and the paint's only going to go where I put the water, so I don't have to really worry too much about it getting into my flowers as long as I'm careful where I put my water down first.
And then I want to add other little colors, too, because it would be kind of like hints of other flowers that may be beyond where we can really see, like on the backside of the bouquet, because, you know, if it's okay, everything's not facing us. Except in my bouquet, pretty much everything is, because I didn't have enough to fill out a whole bouquet. I just had to make sure the pretty stuff was near me so I could actually have enough to paint today. And if you have like a yellow, you might put the mauve next to it to kind of give you a little contrast.
Candace Tobacco, how can I stop my distressed watercolor cardstock from pilling up?
Well, probably not really working it. I haven't used that cardstock. I'm kind of leery about craft companies that come out with watercolor paper, just because it's, if you play, you know, you play your cards right, you can get
artist quality watercolor paper for about the same price.
So I would say probably it's probably designed for more stamping, like stamping and then coloring with your distress markers or watercolor crayons or whatever. So I would not work it at all. That's probably why it's pilling. Or use a softer brush. If you're using a water brush, it should be fine. But if you're using like a bristle brush, that's going to make it want to pill on you. Mm. I do a little shock of yellow back there to make the
Gracie Shack, stand out. What's the weather like in Maine?
It's beautiful today.
Hot and sunny.
Yeah, I wonder how hot it's supposed to get today.
Well, when I left the house, it was 89 degrees on the back deck.
Wow, nice.
Which is why when I go home, I'll be slathering on some sunscreen and then going in the pool. Kim Mayberry, can I use multimedia paper if I have no watercolor paper until next payday?
Yeah, you should be able to. I've used watercolors on like the Canson XL papers and it's worked really well. I wouldn't go scrubbing. We haven't had to do any lifting here, so I think it would be fine.
I have to keep re-wetting my paper areas though because of the heat.
Oh, yeah, and I'm just repeating the same process as I'm wetting an area, dripping in color. Now, see there, I dropped a, I'm going to hold that up, see if you can see it a little bit better. Actually, it probably won't work because I already focused it.
But I've got to get a little bloom there. I don't know if you can see it happening, but I've got a little bloom starting there because I just dropped water on top of paint that was still damp. And see, when I blot it, it kind of lifts it all away. But just one thing you want to worry, not worry about, but just be careful of.
Because when you get a wetter spot of paint or water on top of a
damp area, you get that bloom. But I thought that was, I wanted to show you while it was there.
But I have to stop and re-wet different areas because it's hot out and it's everything's drying.
Rich Bowden, I've seen a lot of channels explicitly state sip and paint, etc., stuff like that, cannot use their tutorials. Has there been some notorious incidents?
Oh, yes, there has.
Now, fill me in. I didn't know that there have been notorious incidents.
Yes, there is.
Gossip, art gossip.
Not only are there notorious incidences, but sometimes these sip and paint companies can be pretty ruthless.
And I have had the sip and paint companies come out to artists and
when the artist said, please stop using my painting in your sip and paints, you know, they even take the thumbnail and put it up on their website. Oh, yeah. And then them turn around and try to sue the artist, the one that they stole it from. I mean, it's insane.
They are just ruthless. And, yeah.
Wow. And, you know, the best part is, I bet 9 times out of 10, if the people at Sip and Paint just asked the artist if they could use their artwork, they probably would okay it.
Oh yeah, and they're like, just ask. You know, give me a link. You just give me, and of course they don't want to give a link.
Reddit or whatever.
They don't want to give a link because then people aren't going to pay to go to the Sip and Paints if they know that they can watch the tutorial on YouTube for free. But they also don't want to pay the artist to license their work so that they could use it. They just expect, well, it's on YouTube, so, and I have the right to use it, basically, as the Sip and Paints company attitude.
Well, that makes me sad because I actually just got a call from my mother-in-law wanting to do a Sip and Paint, raising money for doing a fundraiser, and now I'm like, well, I don't know if I want to give my money to Sip and Paint.
Well, it depends. It's probably not the Sip and Paint. There's a few franchises out there that I think has given a lot of people a bad name.
Gotcha. A lot of teachers aren't part of a franchise. They're just doing it on their own.
Yeah, it's the place in Brewer.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm going to... good to know.
But I mean, I'm not, they're not a franchise. I'm talking some of these big franchises that are making money hand over fist, and they're giving artists a real hard time, and artists have to... and they're pretty much, oh yeah, sue us. You know, that's pretty much their attitude, knowing that that's a lot of money to sue somebody, and most artists don't have it or, you know, aren't willing to risk it.
Yeah. Joe Maskey says, thank you, Lindsay. Not quite ready for large scale yet, but it's a long-term goal.
Oh, it's so fun to paint on the big sheet. I haven't done it too much since my kids have been around, but I could now that they're older. Now I'm turning this around because I want to, so we have this really intense, thick, dense foliage in here. I want to pull out some kind of tendrils and some lighter things so I don't just have a big, heavy gob, kind of like how I have it really light and soft over here. So what I want to do is kind of suggest some leaves, and I'm just painting this with water because I want it to be nice and soft.
And then I'm going to add my colors in here and let them kind of wick out. So I'll start with my sap green, like I have been in the middle. And if you are like these M Gram paints, they're very tacky even after they've been sitting in your palette a long time. So you do need to kind of work it out on your palette a little bit to make sure you don't have a big gob. And if you're going out of the tube, you definitely want to do that. So I'm going to start off with my sap green here, closer to the denser areas. And then I am going to clean my brush and grab some yellow, maybe some yellow ochre, because I don't feel like I've used yellow ochre enough. And just kind of add that in there and just kind of let it softly wick out.
Janine Elise Pike, do you ever use bamboo brushes for watercolor? What techniques are they used for?
I have before. The reason I don't like them that like all the time is because the bristles are very soft and limp, so it's hard to get a lot of control or definition. I have some from some Sumi E sets, but I find them a little bit more difficult to control. They're great for like doing a wash or putting a lot of really juicy color down. So I would use them for wash techniques. Or anytime you want to really loosen up and you're having a hard time loosening up with your other brushes.
D. Murray Murray, have you ever done airbrush painting and how does that go?
I have, but I don't like the noise of the air compressor. If I could get a quiet air compressor, I probably would do it more often. It's just, I've learned during my journey that I prefer less fussy things and I want to just create, and I don't like having the barrier of technology or supplies that take a long time to get set up and going. So that was something I did when I was younger, as I was trying everything, trying to figure out exactly what I wanted to do. And kind of in that big collecting phase, I'm just going to try it all. I love it all. And then, you know, you kind of wean yourself off certain things as you get older. And just for me, I don't like, it's like computerized things. I don't like to have to mess with something just to get to creating. And watercolor is like the shortest route to creating for me.
Christy Marofo, Lindsay, how do your paints stay so soft and juicy in the wells of your palette?
These paints have honey in them, the M. Gram watercolors. So that keeps them, they kind of like, I think they pull moisture from the air. So that, and they also have plenty of glycerin in them, like just the way they're manufactured. So that helps. You can add those items to your watercolors and that will help them stay moisture in the pan. And I'm just wetting some of the background, pulling out just some little bits of color because I don't want it to be too harsh. And I turned my painting around because it's easier for me to attack certain areas if I can kind of approach it with my brush bristles pointing to the corner, the edge I'm trying to work on. And I'm going to do the same thing over here. Some softer areas.
Penny Newcomer, what are your thoughts about Koi watercolors?
Koi. I like the pans. Actually, I was just using mine at the beach day before yesterday. I like them. The reason I like them for a travel kit is because they're not very expensive. And I don't, if something was to happen to them, they fall out of the canoe or whatever, I'm not going to be upset over it. And I can let my kids use them and not worry too much about them because they are like a student grade type paint and they don't contain any cadmiums or anything. They're a little bit more opaque than other colors. I mean, when you thin them down, they become quite transparent, so it's not that big of a deal, but they don't have the characteristics of a lot of like mineral pigmented paints. Like they don't have the granulation. There's just certain, like every color in the set is very similar in texture, but when you get into like painting with other watercolors, you'll notice a big difference within the textures of different colors. And I think that's part of the fun of watercolor, seeing some pigments have big chunky or relatively chunky granules appear in the wash, and then you've got other things that are smoother and clearer. I like that juxtaposition of textures, and you just don't get that with the Koi set. And I think it's, you know, I'm sure it's all synthetic dyes and stuff. I haven't had anything fade. I think the light fastness on it's all right, but it just doesn't have that character that I really like. But I like it for going out to paint in the field because I don't have to worry if anything happens to it. And it's a convenient kit. So, And then you might not even notice the texture and those things until you've been painting for a long time either, you know?
JPC13Art, what happened to your pastel series you were doing?
Oh, yeah. Summer and the kids being home and me being a poor excuse for a...
No.
Yeah, I just got... I got a little...
Got busy.
I still intend to do it. I don't know where the time goes. I don't know what's going on. Where is it going?
You were sick all weekend.
Oh, I know.
Nasty germs from your children came and swept through the house. Margaret Zaleski. Lindsay, you and the Sherpa did watercolors this week. Have you used India ink for watercolor?
Yeah, I have used watercolor techniques with India ink. It works quite well. But you can't lift them up when they're dry. So that's the only drawback. If it's a drawback for you, it might not even be a drawback for you. I just filmed my class for Wonderlust. It's going up next week, I believe, on the Everything Art site. And it's on Bombay India Inks.
Sherry French, I think I have viewed all the tutorials, but I'm looking for an example of a painting of a pouring pitcher. Have you done one?
No, I haven't. That'd be a good one to do, too. I haven't done that. Especially with, like, the liquid watercolors.
That would be a good one.
I did buy some fabric so I could do something with those liquid watercolors. I was going to do pillow covers, but after the couch painting incident, I decided that would be a lot to... I think my husband was a little scared when I mentioned any more home decor projects, so... I think I might make a sarong. I did get a few. I did get quite a bit of paint. I thought it might be fun to do like a sarong.
Beach cover up or something.
Yeah. So now I'm kind of just making myself a little table area. Now I've got a leaf and a couple petals there that I sketched on that I intend on painting. But I think I want to just have some more color down here because I want to weight it. I feel like it needs to be a little more balanced. And I like to use colors I've already used. So I'm gonna just kind of grab some things from my palette. And I think it also makes things feel kind of light and airy when you have the different colors. Like, they could be light reflecting around and just dappling, you know, a sunny table. Sometimes I just go by what I want my painting to feel like versus what would really be there. And I could throw any of these colors in the vase because it would reflect these colors.
Gracie Shack, what watercolor blank cards do you recommend to buy?
I get the Strathmore watercolor cards, and they are available in packs of 10, 50, 30, or 100. And I usually get the 100 packs because I use them in my classes as well. A little cobalt blue in here. So they don't really know. I'm looking at my flowers. I don't really have a direct light source because I have so many lights down here that I'm just kind of giving it a very vague light source. Nothing too, I'm not committing to any sort of light source here, really. I'm just kind of getting some dapply still life texture. And now I'm going to switch to a smaller brush and go in to add some details on some of the flowers. I don't want details everywhere. I just want to kind of highlight some of the focal flowers, maybe recapture a stem here and there. This little... I forgot to paint this petal here, so I'm going to paint that in.
Sherry French is going to add that pouring pitcher to your requests.
Thank you.
She collects antique pitchers, so she would like to have a painting to put
up
with.
Oh, wait
that.
A minute. When you said pouring pitcher, I thought you meant pouring picture, like a picture made when you pour paint on the paper.
No. A pitcher.
I was completely confused. I thought you meant like a, because there's a technique called paint pouring, and you can do it with watercolors or like you can use pouring medium with acrylics. That's what I thought you meant.
No.
That's funny.
That's the danger of living in Maine. Pitcher can be something you pour a drink out of or a photograph. Depends on who you're talking
pitcher.
To. Pitcher. I took a pitcher the other day.
Was it a wicked good pitcher?
A wicked good pitcher. The light was just right.
I just judged the photo contest down at the library for Old Home Week yesterday.
Oh, you did? Ooh.
Yeah, lots of entrants.
I saw someone when I was in Monday come to drop her photos off. Was there? There must have been some good ones. There usually are.
Yeah, there were. There were like 9 in the children's category.
Ooh, good.
And there were, I think, 13 in the adult category. Which, and we live in a small town, so that's pretty good. I have my watercolor class at the library on Monday. If you folks are local, if anybody's local. That's right.
Now that line right there is bugging me, so before it sets, I am just going to dampen my brush, clean it, dampen it, and just kind of soften it. And just push that pigment right out of the way. I don't even need to blot it. But just when you're going in and doing details, be careful not to drip any water on any damp areas, because then you're going to end up with the blooms. Not that it's the end of the world, but if you didn't intend it, it can be upsetting.
Joe Maisky, any tips for mixing a mauve? I'm thinking Quin Magenta with Cobalt or Ultramarine.
Yeah, that should work. Either of those blues should work. And the mauve, if you buy like a mauve, it's going to be a little bit more vivid, but I mean, you can really mix everything with your basic colors. You just might not have quite the intensity that you would getting like a pure mineral color. And actually, you know, I had the Cotman Mauve on one of my palettes, and that's not very expensive, and it's a really nice mauve. So don't poo-poo the Cotman. I see so many people poo-pooing the Cotman line of paints lately, and I really don't get it, because they're made by Winsor & Newton. Yeah, they're not going to be as flashy as other paints, but they're not going to fade on you. And
if you're on the canoe and you drop them in the lake.
Yeah. Exactly.
You're not going to be like, no!
Yeah.
Rich Bowden recommends Cobalt Violet mixed with Cobalt Blue.
Oh, yeah.
He's throwing out his. He's got a Cobalt Pigments video.
And yes, and I did mention his channel earlier. Yes. He's got the Color Chemistry series. Check it out. Subscribe to him. Show him some love. He should have more subscribers than he does. He's one of those channels that, and he has a very, very calm voice. He's British, so he's got very, so you know he knows what he's talking about. Hear that British accent? Like, yeah, he knows what he's saying.
He's the doctor of paints.
That's right.
Elaine Rigby, would you give up your die cutters for a laser? I'm assuming for a laser cutter.
A laser cutter. No, but I might for like a laser beam. I don't know. Ping, ping, bing.
You can thread the children with it and keep them in line.
Yeah.
I'm not very nice.
My children were very nice to me. My girls were very disgruntled today.
Dylan Lee, what can you do if you mess up? Do you start over or do something to make it not visible?
Well, it depends on how bad the mess up is. If it's something like you messed up with something you can cover with another color, then you can cover it up, or I like to collage over it. Or if it's a really bad mess up, then you know, do pastel over it or gesso the paper. And you could do acrylics or oils over gessoed watercolor paper. So, you know, don't throw it away. You've bought and paid for the paper. You okay?
I'm good. I got a tickle in my throat. You could also turn it into a mixed media project.
Yep.
Throw some acrylic paint over it.
Exactly. And watercolor paper is expensive, but it's a great substrate. So, you know, even if you mess it up, just throw on a coat of gesso, use it for acrylics or oils, and you're good to go.
Jewel Smith, have you ever done a self-portrait? If you have, can we see it?
I have, and I couldn't know a clue of where any of them are. I don't keep my art generally, so
Could be anywhere.
Oh, yeah, because I taught art, so I mean, I did many self-portraits because I had to instruct how to do it. They were usually not the most flattering things in the world.
My self-portrait did never come out good because I'm not photogenic, so it would just, sends a shiver up my spine thinking about it. Catherine Claremont, have you ever used leather paints?
No, I haven't. I don't work with leather, so I have not used them. I wonder if they're a dye or a paint. You'd be dyeing them or painting, like the paint would sit on top or dye into it.
You probably want dye because most leather stuff is going to be used, like a belt or a wallet or a purse. So I would assume the dye would stick better, like last longer.
Yeah,
it would soak in versus the pigment would more rest on top.
Yeah, unless you were trying to paint something opaque on it. I got some gourds that I've been intending to like dye
like maybe Woodburn and Dye. I've never, it's on the list. It's way down on the list, unfortunately. But it's something I've always wanted to kind
of. Bottom of the list somewhere.
Yeah. It's on the request list. It's my own request on the request list, well after everybody else's requests.
You'll get to it after you die. It'll be fine. LJC7271. Have you ever done a pen and ink wash?
Yep, I got a chickadee on my channel that I really liked the way it came out. It was very quick and easy. Pen and ink one. I'm doing some really watery, kind of big stroke details on some of these further away sunflowers just to give them a little bit of movement, but I don't want to pull attention back there. And then I'm just going to do a little bit of green here. Add some veining. I can't even see. All my leaves are shriveled up on this poor flower. So I'm just going to try to approximate some veining on this one flower only. And then I'm going to do this leaf down here. I'm going to switch to a bigger brush because that's a little small. And I'm going to just do this with some of this yellowy green, whatever I have on my palette. I'm just going to kind of try to use what I have out. That way I know it'll match, and we're almost to the end, so I don't want to mix up too much extra stuff that might not get used.
Marie Carlson, have you ever done any calligraphy?
I have. I'm not very good at it. I've never had the patience to practice. And so I just put some darker color in there to give the leaf a little shadow. And I think I will scrape in some veins so I don't have to go in and paint them in. And then I'm going to do these two little sunflower petals in cad yellow. Oops, one yellow. That's cad yellow.
Deep. Rich Bowden, confession. I do my conference voice in my videos. It is not my real accent. Rich, oh, really? Oh, you should have kept that secret.
I wonder what his real accent is.
Maybe he's Australian.
Maybe he's got a Cockney voice. Maybe he sounds like, was it Michael Caine, the Batman?
Oh,
the
maybe, Batman, yeah.
What's his name? Not Jeeves. What is it? Mr. Alfred?
Alfred. Alfred.
Oh, I awfully want to spatter this. I really do. I think I got to spatter it.
There we go.
And I'm not even done yet, but I'm just like, I need a little shock of yellow in there. And I'm going to go back to the little brush with a little mauve. I intended to use quinacridone magenta in here. I never did. We didn't need it with the mauve. The mauve and quinacridone were so similar. Grab some of this color, just add it into the petals here at the tip. I guess we all kind of use a different voice when we're on camera because we have to be loud enough.
Oh, I don't have a problem being loud. I'm actually toning it down a little bit so I don't bust open the microphone on the camera.
Well, you are good like 5 feet away from the microphone, so I don't think you'd have to worry about that too much.
I know, but when I get excited, I get loud. It's just part of my personality. Even when I was a kid, Mom was like, "Do you have an indoor voice?" I'm like, "Yes, this is my indoor voice." And she'd wince and walk away. Lindsay, do you think using water brushes can affect what the picture looks like?
It's not going to make it change or anything. You sometimes, like a water brush often doesn't have the detail that a regular paintbrush would have. So, I mean, in that respect, but you would know it while you're painting it. Sometimes it makes it lighter because you have that constant feed of water coming into your brush that you wouldn't have if you were... if you are just using a traditional brush. So, I mean, any brush you use is going to slightly affect your paper, like whether it's the quality of the brush or a type of hair that it is. You know, a stiffer brush will dig up your paper and leave it pilled, where a softer brush won't. A really soft brush is going to give you way more water. A medium synthetic brush is going to give you more pigment. So they'll all affect to a certain extent. I need some shadows underneath my leaf here. So I'm just wetting the paper so I don't get anything too harsh. I'm also going to wet a little bit under the vase so I can drip in some shadows. I'm going to make myself a gray for this. I'm going to use my cobalt and cad orange mix that I still have on my on my paper.
Vicky S., what do you think of Schminky watercolors?
That's another one I haven't used. Again, they're on the pricey side. I love their pastels, and those are on the pricey side. They're my favorite pastels. But I never tried the watercolors, actually. But then again, I think they're also in Marty Owen's top three. So if he likes them, that's good enough for me. I wouldn't hesitate to try anything he recommends, honestly. He always has people's best interests at heart, as far as his reviews are very trustworthy. I just wanted a little bit of pigment, so I went under there with that same gray I mixed. Whoop! I'll shove that up so you can see that. So I just went under there on the dry paper with the paint, and now I'm going to go in with a wet brush and spread it out a bit.
Dominique Designs wishes you a happy belated birthday.
Thank you very much.
How does it feel to be 27?
Feels a lot better than it did last weekend, I'll tell you that. Oh, and we went to the drive-in, because we promised the kids we'd take them to the drive-in to see the BFG.
Yeah.
And Finding Dory. And I was so sick and so achy, and I felt like, why didn't I? Well, I'm like, you kids really any heart set on this? And they did. So I'm like, oh, okay.
You know, you could have called me. I could have schlepped you over some NyQuil. You could have had a couple of NyQuil and just slept in the back of the van while they watched the movie.
Well, that's what I was intending to do. And actually, what I wish I did, I wish I had headphones for my cell phone, because the other screen was playing Tarzan and I could see it perfectly. And staring at Aaron Skarsgård, what's his name, for 2 hours would have made my symptoms.
There are worse things to do for a couple hours. Rich Bowden, he has a West Midlands accent.
I wonder what that sounds like.
He says, I'll do a video in my real West Midlands accent and you won't follow a word.
I don't know. If people can keep up with my main accent, I'm sure that I could keep up with his.
Maybe. Although I will say that that show on Netflix, Peaky Blinders, which takes place in England, they say if you should put on the subtitles, because some of the accents are so hard to understand, that they recommend that you actually watch it with the subtitles. Because you won't get everything. I haven't watched it yet. I want to watch it.
I've heard it's good.
I've heard it's excellent. But the accents are hard for a lot of people.
Kelly Ripa says it's good. On a Regis and Kelly. Not Regis. What is it? Well, it was Michael and Kelly. Now it's whoever they get.
I don't listen to anything she has to say, because she and I are two very different people.
Oh, I like Kelly Ripa. She's a spunky, energetic girl.
We're both spunky and energetic. And then there's me. Not spunky or energetic. I'm the manatee of the dry art world.
I'm defining a little bit of a back table area there, and I'm just going to spread it down with a wet brush. I hope it's straight. I really can't tell. That's the thing when you're working flat. It's hard to tell whether you got your thing straight or not. I wonder who they're going to replace Kelly Ripa's sidekick with. Because I could totally do that job.
I don't know what, she has a sidekick that needs to be replaced?
Yeah, the football guy, was it Michael somebody? He's working for Good Morning America now, I think.
Oh, I don't know. I don't watch morning news things.
I don't often, but I find her delightful when I turn on the TV. If Kelly Ripa's on, I find her delightful.
Well, you and a kabillion other people, because I mean, she's been on TV for a while, hasn't she?
Yes.
So, I mean, she has a following.
She does, and I think anybody that, like, and I'm not a soap opera fan, but I think anybody that acts in a soap opera, that is, like, the marathon, I think, of television, because you're working every day, you film every day, and I think she was doing the soap opera when she started.
I didn't even know she was a soap opera person.
Yeah, she was a soap opera person.
Kobe Ozias, could a vinyl faux leather be heat embossed, and do you know of a paint that could be used on it?
I would say no
to the heat embossing. It'd probably melt it.
I think it would warp it. But you know, I bet you could, because I've done fun foam. Like, you heat the fun foam with a heat tool, then you press a rubber stamp into it, and it gives a beautiful emboss. So I bet you could. I think you'd have to heat the whole thing, the whole piece. As long as it wasn't a piece that was too big, I think if you heated the whole piece and then pressed like a rubber stamp or a metal stamp in it, you could. And then I would probably just go in with an acrylic paint with like a textile medium in it, just to keep it supple enough so that it didn't crack if you like if you bent it.
Maybe if you stretched it too, like put it on a board with some clips.
Yeah, yeah.
Like not stretch, but you know, grip it down with like some, what the,
bulldog clips.
Yeah. On the corners. I don't know.
Yeah, I think you could.
I don't know about any paint that you could use on it.
I think acrylic paint would stick.
You think so?
I do think it will. I think I would just wipe down the vinyl with like a little rubbing alcohol first to make sure there's no grease on it, and then I think you'd be all set. I'm doing some flicks of colors on my palette, basically, to just unify everything. And something you might want to do, I mean, it's totally up to you. We'll try lifting. We'll see if we can lift any highlights off the vase. But you could always, that would have been a good excuse to use masking fluid if you like masking fluid and you haven't done this painting yet because you're waiting until after the broadcast. You could always mask a few areas or even go back in with some white paint if you want to highlight. I'm probably not going to use a white paint, but... your painting, you do whatever you feel like. I just love that purple next to the yellow, so I'm flicking some more of that in. And I think I want to put a little shock of it in the vase, too, just to give it a little bit of life. I like to look at things. If I see an area that I feel is just a little too samey and dull, then I'll go in with the opposite color and kind of coax a little life out of it, like I'm doing here with the mauve and the yellow.
Kim Sim 7.
Oh, hey, Kim Sim 7. I haven't seen you in a while.
She's late. She's a late newt here, but she has a question.
Better late than never.
My aunt wants me to stencil an acrylic design on a fake leather barstool seat. How would I seal it?
A fake leather barstool seat. You know what I would use? I think that's too rigid. I would use, it's a product called Fab.
Okay.
It's by Heirloom Traditions Paint. And that's actually what I used on the couch to keep the paint from coming off.
Mm-hmm.
And you paint the seat with Fab, then paint with whatever water-based acrylic paint you want. Paint your stencil, do whatever you want to do. When that's dry, go over it with another coat of Fab, and that will keep the paint supple and it will protect it. So that's what I recommend.
They make a spray paint. Envirotex makes a finishing.
Oh, it does?
Yeah, they have a spray paint. So I don't know if you could use it on faux leather, but that might be another option too.
Oh, I didn't know that. I thought you meant the pour-on. So
no, no, no.
Of, like, the stuff
no,
used
they
for
make a
trays.
They make a finishing spray, which I have used on like terracotta pots.
Oh yeah.
Put outside, and that seems to work pretty well. But that's not the. I don't know. You have to read the label. I don't have the thing in front of me.
Have you used it on anything flexible?
I haven't. I've only used it on solid surfaces. But it does, you know, they list what you can use it for.
Yeah. Well, I know the Fab will work. It is a little pricey, though, but I think a jar will do you a long time. Okay, so now I want to see if I can lift any highlights out of here. And I'm going to use a stiff brush for that. Any sort of anything with like hog hair or a fabric brush, just be careful if you're using a synthetic fabric brush. They are really stiff bristles and you could end up damaging your paper. But this is the last step, so you're not going to be painting over this. So I'm just going to give this a little scrub back and forth. Remember to use your clean water because you don't want to add more pigment. This paper that I'm using isn't terribly expensive. It's the Fabriano 140 pound block. Oh, and if you hate spending a lot of money on watercolor blocks, make sure you come back this weekend. Tomorrow, I'm going to have a DIY watercolor block tutorial. I successfully made a watercolor block, and I took it on the field, and I tested it, and it worked. And I'm going to show you guys how to do it, and it doesn't take any expensive supplies, so you guys can use your regular sheet paper and turn it into blocks. Oh, and I like how I'm getting some light in there now. It is lifting up. I like that. I'm going to go in here. So this vase has flat sides. It's like a hexagon type of vase. So I just want to kind of get those lines. And never rub. I've seen some people rub their paintings and not damage them somehow. But I always recommend you press straight down and you lift up when you are scrubbing and lifting. So you don't put any undue stress on your watercolor paper. And this is just about going to do it. Do we have any other questions in the...
Yes, Kobe Ozias, the question about painting the faux leather.
Mm-hmm.
She's thinking about using embossing powder.
I think that's going to crack off because embossing powder is very rigid.
Yeah.
And then, and that's just a lot of those, I think any sort of seat like that isn't going to, it's going to be too
too rigid. The seat cushion will move, but the embossing powder won't, and it will crack and split. Just getting a few accent lines of detail in here. And I lost a little of the purple that I liked, so I am going to go put a little bit more of that back.
Kim Sim wants to know where she can get the fab. And she's excited about the color block.
Oh, cool.
Watercolor block.
Cool. Actually, if you go to heirloomtraditionspaint.com, I do have I've used the fab on my couch painting project. That's on my website if you want to see that. But use the coupon code FRUGAL for 10% off. And then they'll know that I sent you, and that'll make them pleased, I'm sure. I don't know.
But it saves you 10%, so why not? And I would get the clear. There is a kit that you can get the clear and the primer, but if you're going over something really dark with something light, you might want the primer,
but it's going to just kind of give a white tone to everything. And with Barstools, you're not going to need that much product. That's going to be kind of overkill. So I would just get one jar of the clear for a set of Barstools,
unless you think you might want to go paint your couch, which I'll tell you, that's an undertaking. And I don't know if I
would really recommend running out and painting your couch because once you start, you can't go back. It's like you're Frodo going for the ring, and you've gotten like past Lothlorien, and you decide, oh geez, I don't know about this. I think you can't turn back. You know, you've gone too far.
You have to
go to Mordor. You know, that's what painting the couch is like. It's like, oh, I'm.
You just leave it half painted.
You can't leave it half done. Yeah, that was a crazy week. All right, so this pretty much does it. I'm just going to do a little bit of sap green and cobalt blue on this leaf. I think I have no idea what time it is even.
It is 1:51.
Oh, an hour and a half. I was thinking this is taking longer. But I kind of like our little bouquet here. It was a lot of fun to paint.
Mm.
And you can keep fussing around, little details if you want to add like shadows in the centers of the flowers. But
don't remember to walk away before you overfuss with
it. Yeah, I think I'm in the danger zone of overfussing. If you guys have any last minute questions, go ahead and pop them in right now, and we'll see what we can do. Are we backlogged on questions?
No,
already?
We're actually caught up. They're all laughing about the reference to Frodo and Mordor.
We're all geeks here. You're folding laundry and watching Doctor Who and
the Doctor. We just found out that River Song is the daughter of
Rory
and the redhead. I can't remember her name right now. I was like, oh,
Pond, Amelia Pond. Yeah,
God, Amy Pond. Yeah. Lord, I was like, thankfully it's all backlogged on Amazon, so I don't have to wait till the fall to get the rest of the episodes.
Good.
I can just stream it on Amazon, which I admit I will probably do when I get back to finish folding the laundry.
That's not bad. I miss Captain Jack. He was my favorite character of all the Doctor Who characters.
But you can see him on, because he was on the other
Torchwood,
yeah. Which I think they might, I don't know, they had it on Netflix. I don't know if they still do.
Do you know Torchwood is an anagram for Doctor Who?
I didn't, but I do now.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Yay.
All the geeky trivia you ever wanted. And painting, too.
Yes, Rich, I know I'm behind on Doctor Who, but they got rid of it on Netflix, and we had to wait for it to come on Amazon, and I'm a late starter to Doctor Who. So I'm a recent nerd, okay?
I'm behind, too. I don't think I've seen anything with Peter Capaldi in it yet.
I
or maybe
either.
I've seen one or two with him in it. But
I'm a late bloomer. As I get older, I get nerdier and nerdier, so.
Yeah.
What can I
say? We'll get you watching Buffy before long.
Ooh, I don't like Sarah Michelle Gellar.
But you know,
she bothers me.
Because she's a perky blonde. Is that why?
No.
Kelly Lurpa.
I just don't like her. I don't think she's a good actress. And I don't like, I don't know.
But the Buffy Spike romance, it's like epic. It's the epicest.
Yeah.
All right, do we have any more questions?
We've
given them time.
People still can't find the link for the traceable.
Oh, just go to my scroll down, click on my crafty blog link, and it's right
Shelley,
there.
Shelley Parchman just put the link up.
Oh, sweet.
Okay, I think we're done.
Awesome. All right. If you need any art supplies, go check out our sponsor, jerrysartorama.com. I was using the M. Graham watercolors today. They're my favorite. I've been using them for about 15 years. I really like them. So there's a solid bet if you're looking for a good artist quality set. If you want a less expensive artist quality set, the Turner paints over at Jerry's are a great buy, especially if you get the 5 milliliter intro set for $29. This is a great way to get into it and have some high quality paints. I will post the finished picture of this on my blog and Facebook page in a little bit, so you can refer to that as well. And I want to thank you all for joining us. Please give a thumbs up in the little thumbs up box and share it with your crafty friends. And thanks again so much for watching. And until next time, happy crafting!